cartoonist. I used to look at drawings in newspapers, and that's the sort of thing I wanted to do. And I went to talk to a man in one of the Sydney newspapers, told him what I wanted to do, and he said, "You'll have to go to art school for 3 years before you can become a newspaper artist." My parents didn't have enough money to send me to art school, and so this man suggested that maybe I ought to be an apprentice to the printing trade, which is what happened to me. I became an apprentice in the rotogravure printing trade, where I learned huge amounts of stuff about photography, graphic design. A lot of the people that I worked with when I was a young apprentice were slightly older men who were serious amateur painters, and that set me thinking, I'd love to do that too. And we used to go out drawing at lunchtimes and all around Woolloomooloo, and so that's how I got to be an artist, I think, from wanting to draw, always wanting to draw, and then meeting all these people who were doing it. They inspired me. I started in the printing trade, I was 16. I think probably I was more like 18 when I started seriously thinking of myself as an artist. I became fascinated with a group of people in Sydney who still are known as the Sydney Push. A whole lot of bohemians that used to drink a lot. And I really loved the company of all those people in the Push, and they all talked philosophy and art, and it was just a totally new world to me. There was a little commercial gallery called the Barry Stern Gallery. Barry Stern saw one of my paintings and he came to see me and he said, "I'd like to have a show of your work." So that's how I came to have my first exhibition. I have never made a living from painting, from my artwork. I've sold the occasional piece, but no, it's never been a commercial activity for me. I'm the worst person in the world at selling my own work. I'm not a commercial operator. I don't understand how to sell my work. I've never been good at it. When I started, of course, I painted pretty much from real life, landscapes and things like that, still lifes and so forth. But there's, in virtually all of my work, there's a tendency towards abstraction. And at sometimes I have tried to be completely abstract to make geometric painting. My sort of entry to abstract painting was probably fairly quick because once I started showing with the Contemporary Art Society in Sydney, a lot of the artists who showed there were abstract painters, and I liked their work and I wanted to paint like that, or wanted to work like that. A very strange thing for an artist to be, but I'm colourblind. As a painter, it's a very difficult thing to be a colourblind painter, but I believe numbers of other artists are colourblind. I don't know who, but I've heard that quite a number of painters have been known to be colourblind. I'm not completely colourblind, I'm what's called red-green colourblind, and so I can see clearly yellows and blues, but I can't always distinguish reds and greens. Sometimes I mistake green for grey or grey for green and things like that. Yeah, so it's a funny thing, this colour blindness, but that may be why I have been very much drawn to painting and ink drawing, because you don't have to have colour vision to do that. I think graphic arts, drawing, painting, drawing and watercolours are what I feel most comfortable with, but I did do quite a lot of oil painting when I first started working as an artist. The possibilities of watercolour and ink drawings and things like that are what I've found I'm best at. Yeah, I joined the Contemporary Art Society pretty early in my career. I'm pretty sure I was still working as an apprentice in the printing trade, and I'd come home and I found that working on the night shifts actually were very good, because when I worked on the night shift, I'd come home at about nearly just before midnight, and I could stay up for a few hours drawing, and then I could wake up in the morning, and of course I had children too, and I had to get them to school, so I ended up, I had to care for the children and do the drawings, and I did it all. I mean, I don't know how I got all the energy, but I did. I was a young person, I suppose, and young people can do anything. I had a job where I could actually choose to be on the night shift. Although the company would say, you're on day shift this week, and next week you're on another shift, but I could actually choose. To some extent, I could choose which shifts I'd work on, and I always chose the night shift because it gave me that freedom in the daytime. I was the breadwinner. I bought a little house in Redfern, and the tiniest little house you've ever seen. I sometimes go past it, and it's amazing how small it how small it is. And but you know, that's the way we had to live in those days. For most of my creative life, I've been taking photographs. I took them with great care. I love taking the photographs, and they became a sort of document of they documented all sorts of events in my life, my partnerships, my relationships, my children, all of those things, all of those people and things have been subjects of my photography, but I have never actually, until very recently, never shown my photographs publicly. Things I make I like to think that they are objects in their own right, that they don't need to be explained in terms of what they might mean. They certainly might mean all sorts of things, but they are also, as I keep coming back to saying this, they are things in the real world. I always loved going to films. I was always a movie goer. I love films, and because I knew a lot about photography, I borrowed a 16mm camera. I made a film that used my drawing skills to make graphics, and I made an animated film called Swan Song in Birdland, which was a kind of parable about the end of the world, and you know, because we're all terrified about nuclear destruction in those days, and that's the subtext of the film. Sydney Bush, and we were talking one day about how I had made this film, and we got together with not just Albie and me, but two other people, a man called John Clark and a guy called Aggie Reed. There were four of us, Aggie, John Clark, Albie and myself. And we had a meeting at Albie's house and we called ourselves Ubu Films. And then for the next 5 years, we were really flying, you know, all of us and many other people in Sydney, people like Gary Shedd. We all showed our films all over Australia, really, under the name of Ubu Films. Was a convention that filmmaking was something that Australians could not do, didn't do and couldn't do. They didn't have the skills or the knowledge or anything else. And we just thought that's absolute bullshit. We knew we had the skills, we knew we had the desire to make the films and we did.
I've got some pictures for you to look at. This photograph was taken by my father about 40 years ago. I made the print from his original negative. When I was very young, I was fascinated by those mysterious slippery black negatives which recorded my father's love of the bush and which burned with such a nauseating smell. I think I learned more about my father from his photographs than I did from him. That's me when I was very young.
Showing that Ubu Films put on was we gathered the films from various people who either we'd heard about or I can't remember the fine details of it, but somehow or other we got in contact with a number of people who usually they were working in the commercial film industry, but they were also working privately on their own personal films. And it was those personal films that we were interested in. And so we organised, Albie and John Clark and myself had made a send-up film of the James Bond films. We did a film called Blunderball, which is a wonderfully hilarious send-up of the James Bond character, who was at that time just becoming important, really important in popular culture. So we made a send-up of the Bond films, and then we got quite a lot of press coverage, and we became sort of famous.
Jim Bond had stumbled onto something. Far from being a champion card player, the arch criminal Goldfoot was being given his moves through an electric impulse received in his foot. Bond decided to give Goldfoot a dose of his own medicine.
One of the partners in Ubu had his own 16mm camera, that's John Clark. And John Clark became our cinematographer, and because he had the camera. But he had the skills, there's no question about that. He could do the job very well.
I could only answer Lydia's doubts with a puzzle, a story about something that happened to me a long time ago. When I was a young man, politics was a very dirty word, so I studiously avoided such matters. But looking back, I can see links and coincidences enough to make a detective story. Not only was 1953 the year that Stalin died, but it was also the year that Tatlin died. In 1953, Picasso did a very bad portrait of Stalin, and I read only today, I am speaking in the present, of course, that Picasso had a plan to do a portrait of Stalin as an heroic male nude. Back in 1913 or 14, Tatlin visited Picasso in Paris at that truly heroic time in art history, when Cubism was at its height, when the paint on those canvases I saw in New York was still wet, when the Cubists had taken to its logical conclusion Cézanne saying that underlying nature were the cube, the cone, the cylinder and the sphere. And inside the monument, of course, were those very forms that Cézanne had spoken of. The cube, the pyramid, which has the same profile as a cone, the cylinder and the sphere, or at least a hemisphere. But in 1953, I knew none of that. All I knew was that I wanted to make pictures.
When I make paintings or make photographs or make films, I see them all as things in the real world. They're objects, they're not just symbols. A lot of people, I think, see films as just symbols about something else that's in the filmmaker's mind. But I mean, although films are that, for me they're also real objects in the real world, and and that's where I think the abstraction comes in. The abstraction is the result of seeing the work, the things I make, as just objects. They are symbolic, of course. They have their symbolic meanings, but they also are just, as well as that, they're real things in the real world.
In the 25th year of my age, I find myself to be a dromedary that has run short of water between one oasis and the next mirage. And having despaired of ever making my obsessions intelligible, I am content at last to be the sole clerk of my metamorphosis. The question of the age. Meaning or feeling It is difficult to find oneself working with such frenzy, but as that old shit, Uncle Joe, said, he who does not work does not eat. Yes, indeed.
Although I know I have messages that come out through my work, I don't. That's not where I start. I do not start from wanting to make propaganda. I don't start from wanting to convince people that I know anything about real life. I mean, I don't want to. I want to make things. As I keep saying, I just want to make objects. But in the process of doing that, I'm actually, I recognise I'm making symbols. There's all sorts of psychological aspects to making art that is clearly evident to anyone, and it's the making of the object that gives me the great pleasure.
I don't understand any of this. I mean, who gives a shit about the Bolsheviks? The commos are fucked. Anyhow, people just want a good story.
Yeah, but this job's paying our bills, so let's get on with it.
I was born at the time of Hitler's coming to power. My parents never spoke about such things, of the war which followed. On holidays with my uncles and aunts in the country, I heard fragments of conversation that somehow made the war a little more comprehensible. But what I gained from my parents was an impression that the war, perhaps even most of human behaviour, was so repugnant that it was best not to speak of it at all.
I was born in 1933, the very year that Hitler came to power. It's always blighted my memory, the thought that Hitler and I started at the same time. I suppose I don't accept that anyone has the right to tell me how to live my life. So how did I become an anarchist? Probably through the Sydney Push. The Sydney Push was a group of, as I might have talked about it before, the Sydney Push were a group of intellectuals, artists and drinkers who used to gather at several pubs in Sydney and they promoted the idea very strongly that one could not be told how to live by governments or by churches or by anything else, that one should be free to make one's own choices about how you live your life. I have just recently been, only last week or so, I went to a little conference over in Glebe where there was a man talking about exactly that, anarcho-communism. That was the subject of his talk. I didn't make a lot of sense out of it, but there you are. But it is possible for people to think of anarchism and communism in the one breath.
Soon after we got here, there was another election. The government won, but with fewer seats. Some of my friends were deeply involved in politics. I shared their interest and their sympathies, but not their involvement. I was an outsider, preoccupied with my creativity.
The notion of personal freedom is very ambiguous in Australian society, I think. There's a very strong authoritarian philosophy at work in Australia, which goes way back to the origins in the British Empire, I suppose. I'm not very good at talking about these things. I prefer to think of myself as an artist than an intellectual.
The thing that Russian government doesn't have to worry about marching down Ruthven Street or Queen Street to get its point of view across, because they use your money to do it.
Some students and I made a documentary about political events in town. Since the fall of the Whitlam government, resistance to conservative policies in Queensland was reduced to a series of rallies and processions. And processions on the street were banned. Dissent versus authority. And the conflict is recorded for entertainment on that night's TV, even in a country town. I know that great changes have come about this way. But we who call ourselves the left in Australia had suffered a huge failure of nerve when the government was dismissed 2 years before. There was no popular defence then, and less now, against revived conservatism. Even when taking these pictures, I felt a sense of futility. We had already lost this battle.
In the political developments, Mr. Whitlam has been sacked as Prime Minister by the Governor General. Mr. Fraser has taken over as caretaker Prime Minister, and the budget has been passed. The Parliament has been dissolved, and there'll be an election for both the House of Representatives and the Senate, probably before the year is out. And unionists are already mounting a campaign of protest against the dismissal of Mr. Whitlam.
The United States, Europe, all of those places, the idea of personal liberation was a very attractive one, and one that a lot of the people who actually controlled our society weren't happy about. I mean, there was the notion that there was certainly a very authoritarian streak in the Australian culture that said that you're not allowed to do all sorts of things.
My filming in New York had shown me a futurist city, not futurist in Marinetti's violent way, but futurist in the Russian sense of idealism, a world, in Marshall Berman's words, where everything is pregnant with its contrary, ironic, polyphonic and dialectical, denouncing modern life in the name of values that modernity itself has created. In the New York Times, such moral dilemmas were irrelevant. Communism there was, as always, indistinguishable from Stalinism. But when a bureaucratic, authoritarian administration regards many of its own people as enemies, is that not identical with Stalinism? Stalin has been compared to Hitler. But Stalinism is not fascism. Fascism is about domination, psychotic, in love with death. Stalinism is far more ordinary than fascism. Anyone can be a Stalinist.
Russia. Probably for as long as I can remember, the Soviet Union and the communism that operated them there, they were held up as some kind of ideal in amongst a lot of intellectuals in Australia, and I listened to what they said. There was a belief that communism was the way of the future. It, not only in Russia, but everywhere in the world. And I was drawn to the idealized ideas that we thought were what made the Soviet Union work. But I was never, but because I was also an anarchist, there was a sort of a dissonance between my ideals of anarchism and the fantasies about communism. And really, I don't think I ever resolved that completely for myself until about 1990-91, when Lydia and I went to Russia, and I actually saw the place when the Soviet Union was just falling apart. Boris Yeltsin had taken power.
I had noticed people gathering at the back of the store across the road. This morning, the temperature was down to zero as I began compressing 1 hour into 30 seconds. The queues of the Soviet Union were, of course, notorious. I never did find out what the purpose of this one was, but knowing its purpose would not change its bleakness. No doubt what I did here was spying. My only excuse, lame and pathetic as it is that I shared these people's coldness as I filmed them.
The place was an absolute mess. It was such a tragic mess. Everybody was poor. All the structures of society were falling apart. And at that point, I realized that any sort of social organization that was like the Soviet Union couldn't work. I saw it in front of my own eyes. It just couldn't work. And so all of those ideals that intellectuals had in the Western countries, and particularly in Sydney, I think, ideals of socialism being a good thing to a good way to organise society, I could see that it couldn't work. It's certainly not in the way that they did in the Soviet Union, anyhow. But it took, until then, it took, most of my life to come to that realisation, because being a bit of an idealist, I always sort of hoped that there was a better way than the system we were living under. Are living under the capitalism that operates in Western countries seemed to me to be not the best way anyhow to organise life. And so going to the Soviet Union taught me a lot, and I made a film. When Lydia and I went to Russia, I shot a lot of film, both before we went and when I was there. And I'm at the last part of the film I made there is sort of a documentary about, a very personal documentary about my observations, and our observations of what was really happening there.
When it had begun to dawn on me that Russia wasn't so far away after all, I then could dare to hope that I would get there. For a long time, it had been in the back of my mind that I would very much like to see Vladik again and see what was going on with my family and that country. I never had a sense that I wanted to go back to the birch trees and the steppes and things like that. It's a spiritual thing, the songs, the icons, the feeling of what it is to be Russian on Russian soil. Was what I really wanted to find out about.
The most political drawing I've ever done, Trotsky. Trotsky with the pickaxe in his head. This one I like a lot. It's sort of got all of the abstract qualities that I like to work with, and it sort of vaguely suggesting some kind of industrial landscape. This one is based on a little tiny sketch that I made one day when Lydia and I went somewhere for dinner in town, and we were in a seafood restaurant, and the people near us had this huge seafood plate of crabs and all that stuff. And so I did a little tiny sketch, pencil sketch, and then when I brought it home, I made that painting from the sketch. Did you get this one? This is a very early painting when I first started painting, and its date is 1954 and 2003. I got it out and sort of touched it up in 2003. So there's about 50 years difference between when it started and when it was finished. Mm-hmm. It's based on a photograph of a partisan who was fighting the Nazis when the Nazis invaded Russia. And so that's a bit about my idealism about the Soviet Union. I was the eldest. My parents had six other children besides me. All of us are very different from each other. We very rarely see each other, except one sister who I'm very fond of, who I talk to a lot. The suburb that I grew up in was just a few houses in the bush. My parents were not well off. You'd say we were poor, basically. We didn't. I never starved, but we didn't have a lot of money. I had an exhibition, almost a retrospective, I suppose, at the Mossman Art Gallery towards the end of 2009, which for the first time enabled me to show paintings, drawings, photographs and films, all in the one exhibition in this quite lovely exhibition space. And with the help of Albie and Lydia, we got the exhibition together, and I think it was quite a successful show. It was fascinating to see all this work I had done over the years and all the different media I've worked in, and to see it all up there on the wall, it gave me a very good sense of what I've actually done, you know.